Welcome to Talking Beats. I hope you'll subscribe and give us a 5-star review on Apple, Spotify, or anywhere you get your podcasts. If you like the show, please consider supporting us at patreon.com/talkingbeats. That's patreon.com/talkingbeats. We believe now more than ever in providing a platform for individuality, free thought, and a diverse range of views. By supporting the show this way, you'll get early access to episodes, bonus episodes, and much more. And remember, the conversation is always active at Talking Beats Podcast on social media. On today's program, we're speaking with former United States Senator Heidi Heitkamp. The Democrat, who for 8 years served as Attorney General for North Dakota, was the first woman elected to the U.S. Senate from that state. In the Senate, she was known for her ability to work across the aisle and for her advocacy for rural Americans. In her time since leaving the U.S. Senate, she served as a visiting fellow at the Institute of Politics at the Harvard Kennedy School. I began by asking her if she would run again for Senate. This question was prompted by my re-watching of her farewell speech from the Senate floor, in which I saw sincerity, in which I saw heart. These are two things you can't fake. These are things the American public needs more of. Here's what former Senator Heidi Heitkamp had to say.
You know, I think that to everything, there's a season, right? And you have opportunities to serve. And I talked a lot about that. But I talked a lot about civility and working together. And, you know, it really is my goal to try and create a more calm, if I can use that word, but a more civil, a more thoughtful political process. And I think in this country, in order to do that, we need a more thoughtful civil body politic. We've become so polarized. And I think that leadership has to, that's why I'm so excited about this next election, because it really is not just about policy and what's happening right now with our democracy, but it is about leadership style. And what does that look like? And hopefully we can get back to kind of agreeing to disagree and working together to achieve something. But it can't be driven by one or two people. It has to be driven by a change in how we approach our democracy. And so I'm involved in a number of efforts with some really interesting people right now in terms of promoting not just democracy in our country, but democracy globally. And I'm involved in trying to reestablish those relationships that we've had across the globe that have secured liberty for so many people in the world and that now are being threatened. And so, you know, like I said, there's everything to a season, and we now take on the mantle, I mean me, of citizen, and that's a pretty important job, and I've always taken that seriously too.
You mentioned thought, you mentioned civility. I think these are very aspirational sounding words today. I call myself a middle-aged millennial, so kind of right in the middle of the millennial generation. I think about thought. I think about what we're doing now, sort of substantive long-form conversation where things aren't built for a 30-second soundbite, and the point isn't a gotcha moment, but it's to get a feel for the person and for the person's hopes and goals. And I wonder how you transmit that to a body of people, 330 million people, who are impatient. Americans are impatient. I had Drew Faust on recently. She said, we're very impatient. We wanted a vaccine yesterday. You know, how do you get through when what you're talking about is a pivot, a major shift in thinking?
First off, let's just kind of examine whether it is a major shift in thinking. I mean, every day you see on social media, and it can be a cesspool of evil behavior, but every day you see just amazing things like a young boy helping somebody who's not as physically able make a basket and cheer up his day. We're fundamentally incredibly good people in this country, and we're generous, and we are community-oriented, but somehow Washington hasn't gotten that message and hasn't provided the kind of leadership in our national politics that reflects what I think is the majority of really good people in this country. And so I think we need to create space for that kind of cooperation and collaboration and thoughtful analysis, because Americans do it every day in their daily lives. You know, I used to tell a story. I grew up in a small town of 90 people in Manitou, North Dakota. My family was 1/10 the population. And I said there were Democrats and Republicans, and they would sit down at the coffee table and have huge political debates. But at the end of it, they figured out how to get the Christmas lights up and fix the church roof and make sure that our fire department was funded. And so people do it every day in America. And we just need to somehow find that community spirit that's already exists in America. We need to figure out how we reignite that in our political world at a national level.
I think you have an interesting vantage point because you're from an enormous state, extremely rural, enormous in terms of geography, 53 counties, North Dakota. You came to Washington, obviously highly densely packed, different feeling there, different situation. What did you bring from your experiences working in the government and in private life in North Dakota? What did you bring in to Washington that you felt could be duplicated somehow? You're talking about, in a sense, a civility, a civics education.
I think if I had to kind of pinpoint one thing that that I brought to maybe the caucus and maybe to the Senate, it was this attitude when I got there. I would say, hey, this is a really good idea, and I would have a really good idea. And if you know me, you know I fall in love with my ideas. I think that you know, there's so much great things that can happen if you believe in the strength and the power of ideas. And I would say, this is a great idea. And I would hear this. They would say, oh yeah, that's a really good idea, but it'll never happen. And I said, you guys have given up. You've given up on believing you can, in fact, get things done. And when you give up on believing that you can get things done, you will never get things done. And I think one thing in North Dakota is this expectation that you make a decision and you move on, and you make a decision in a way that not everybody's going to be happy, but hopefully everybody's been heard. And I think it's that kind of belief in the power of a good idea and the power of working together to achieve it, even if it's not perfect, and getting things done. And I'm proud that there was a number of things that I was able to accomplish. It's just that we are now in a political world where we don't reward accomplishment. We simply vote for a political party. And we've got to get beyond that, because there's got to be political awards and successes for people who actually get things done.
Let me just step back for a second. I want you to take us back before we go forward into this fall and your predictions. I'll ask you to be a predictor, but take us back. You don't need to predict. Paint a picture of history, how you grew up. You mentioned a town of 90 people. You were one of seven siblings. I would say your family was middle class, maybe. Mm-hmm. Talk about how you first discovered your love for interacting with people, for giving back, for service.
I think it always comes from expectations that your family sets on you. So let's take a look at my mom and dad, really two very different people. My mom, much more emotional, and my dad, very stoic. But my dad was a community leader. When my dad died, the parish priest, Father Grady, did a eulogy, and he said, you think of Jesus of Nazareth and Ray of Manitou. And that was because if you needed a ballpark, my dad organized and got a ballpark. If Mrs. Poster needed her sidewalk shoveled so she could go to mass in the morning, your dad sent the kids over to do it. We were just taught at a very early age that part of our obligation and our responsibility, and then eventually part of our joy in life, was to be helping other people and doing things for a community. My mother was a little different, and I think sometimes resentful of all of my dad's community activity because it took time away from the family. But she was a voracious fighter for the underdog. If a kid was having trouble or getting picked on, he'd be the first person who'd get a hug, and he'd be the first person with an extra slice of homemade bread, you know, for hot lunch. And so my mom taught us that, yes, you can do community things and be involved in the community, but at the end of the day, you also have an obligation to other people around you, and you have to be listening. And, you know, my dad, we used to come home and we would say, oh, that's so-and-so at school. I'm so mad at them. You know, they did this. And my dad never said, oh, that's terrible. He would say, why do you think they did that? And I think that all of us were raised with that sense of, every one of us with that sense of empathy and looking beyond yourself and trying to figure out why things are the way they are and how you can effectuate change. And so I was just blessed with an incredible set of parents who, you know, we were in the community really poor as church mice, frequently couldn't afford the grocery bill, but we were always very rich in ideas and commitments.
You made an interesting point. You mentioned how not only were you exposed to the service and the communal aspects of what you could do, but actually you fell in love with it. I think a lot of kids have the exposure, but then they see it as something they have to do. Let me just get through this community service so I can run off to Snapchat or Instagram these days. Obviously you didn't have that as your option, but you had other equivalent things maybe. But for you it became a passion, and you realized I'm putting words into your mouth, but you realize either knowingly or unknowingly that you had an ability to bring people together to sit around the table over a cup of coffee and say, Republican, Democrat, let's put up the Christmas lights.
Yeah. I mean, I frequently give talks, and certainly used to do it in person, to the girl states or the boy states or high school classes. And what I would say is, you know, don't ever say you're giving back. I said, because when you do service, you get so much more than you will ever give. You get that sense of who you are as a person. It is the greatest feeling in the world to know that you have made a difference in someone else's life, that you have made their path easier. Not because, you know, being raised Christian and Catholic, it's your obligation, but because it builds your character, and you know you're sending out something into the universe of karma, if you want to call it that, that hopefully will come back and be circulated. You know, kindness is contagious, but kindness is what we do for ourselves as much as what we do for other people.
You're talking about sort of kitchen table issues, sitting around. What about when it comes to the Senate? You were there, you were in Washington, you probably had times when you wondered, why the hell is this so difficult? Can't you see the light? I wonder, is there a time and a place that you see, maybe you have wisdom on this front, that people can, in the Senate, be more like Heidi Heitkamp?
They have to be willing to risk their political career. And unfortunately, a lot of people's response to that is, well, let's do term limits. And I always say, you got term limits, they're called elections. And it's a shortcut. I jokingly sometimes say, let's only elect terminally ill people. Let's not have term limits, let's elect terminally ill people. Because if they're terminally ill, they're motivated by leaving a mark or building a better future. They're not motivated by their own personal kind of lens. I would say that the most discouraging part of this is when 90% of what you're trying to do, you can agree on. Let's take COVID relief right now. And why is that so hard? And it's so hard in two parts, because ideology leads instead of ideas. But also special interest plays a huge role in, well, we can't do that because it'll make this special interest mad. And people kind of look at special interest as special corporate interest, which is certainly true. But you also have special interest that is, you know, whether it is the environmental movement or whether it's the evangelical movement, those are groups that have a lot of say in terms of how you proceed on any given issue. And if they decide that perfect is going to be the enemy of good, you end up in gridlock. And that's a lot of what we're seeing now. What I think I tried to bring to the Senate, and this is a great example, it's a passion of mine. You take a look at the war on poverty, and you take a look at, healthcare and all of the social challenges we've had, now this incredible increase in suicide, which should alarm everyone. It's an epidemic that's going unrecognized, I think, and alarming rates of addiction. And you say, why, after all of this investment and what we know right now in terms of the science of addiction, do we continue to struggle with this issue? And you look behind the curtain and you see something like childhood trauma, and you realize that childhood trauma is a huge indicator of whether someone is going to be successful in life and whether they're going to be healthy. And so I looked at this and said, look, that's something that's not talked about. And I'm going to do everything that I can to raise awareness. And we did it very gradually. We started with staff, which is so important, in the Senate, and started talking about childhood trauma, bringing in experts. And we started doing these monthly meetings, and we had small attendance to begin with. And eventually we had 200-300 people, staff people, would come to these on both sides of the aisle, because people are hungry for understanding and meaningful, interventions that can actually change outcomes. And as a result, about a third of our childhood trauma bill was embedded in the opioid bill. And so those are things that people say, well, what are you proud of? You'll never know that. And hopefully this movement will continue, because people like Al Franken was very involved in this when Al and I worked on it, Dick Durbin, and now Catherine Masto, and certainly Kamala Harris has been a leader on childhood trauma interventions. Those are the things that actually can change outcomes. They aren't going to happen tomorrow. But if we address childhood trauma, eliminating trauma, number one, should be our priority, but also intervening at a very early age, we can change the trajectory for so many children, which eventually changes the trajectory of this country. And so Washington is a powerful place for those kinds of interventions, but you have to have leadership that believes in looking at an old issue in a different way and applying different structural changes to achieve more meaningful results.
Speaking about looking at an old issue in a different way, there's no older issue than the treatment of Native peoples in this country. Can you give us a bit of a background? I think a lot of people are confused or just don't have any idea what the situation is. Let's just talk about your state, North Dakota, for Native Americans. You have a long history of support, of dialogue with Native peoples in your state. What are the tribes like? What are the numbers like? I think a lot of people know that, for example, suicide rates, you mentioned suicide before, nationally growing for Native children, 15 to 24, the suicide rates are 2.5 times the national average. The high school graduation rates are much lower. The increase of child mortality, as the decrease for the general population has happened, it's increased for Native peoples. This is a situation that's really bad. And again, age old, we don't hear a lot about it.
Well, I think in part, if you don't have exposure to an issue, you somehow ignore it. Somehow, our first Americans, which are Native Americans, have become last in the hearts and minds of problem solving in Washington. We've ignored our treaty obligations. I could go on and on. What I want to say to your listeners is I want to recommend a book written by Byron Dorgan, a great friend of mine, former senator from North Dakota. Byron used to give speeches. In fact, one of the great compliments that I received from the Senate staff, the people who run the Senate, is that my speeches on Native Americans would remind them of Byron. And Byron gave a speech on a regular basis, and he had a picture of a young girl who was in the foster care system, Native girl, and she, the picture was from the Bismarck Tribune. And he would talk about the conditions of Native American children. And as he transitioned out, he used his leftover campaign dollars to form a nonprofit to enhance opportunities for Native youth. It's since been incorporated into the Aspen group. And so Byron wrote a book called The Girl in the Photograph. And I would recommend it to everyone if they really want to understand this. Now, be ready to feel a lot of despair and a lot of sadness, but understand that we can solve these problems, but we need to recognize generational trauma and what happens when you subject an entire society to genocide and then systematically trying to eliminate their culture through boarding schools and taking away language, and now trying to reestablish all of that basis for human development kind of retroactively, and how do you put it all back together? And you can't do it without collaboration. And to me, we need to first and foremost honor our obligations, but we need to understand the level of trauma that history has imposed on these beautiful Americans. And we need to stop brushing it under the rug and start realizing that we all have a stake in improving the quality of life of every American child. And so I would just say your listeners should buy the book, and all the proceeds as a result of the sale go back into Byron's Foundation for Native Youth, so you can feel really good about going out at Christmas time and buying The Girl in the Photograph. I think it's one of the most significant civil rights books of my time in politics, and it raises an issue that is so incredibly critical to the Plains people and our first Americans.
Can I ask maybe an obvious or awkward sounding question, but in a state like North Dakota, a large rural state where there is a long history and many pockets of Native populations, how obvious is it to the average North Dakotan that this is a problem for Native people? I'm talking about non-Native North Dakotans. How is it screaming there and in New York and California, you know, no one cares? Or I mean, is it also brushed under the rug right there?
Well, I think that if you had some of my friends, they would say there is a level of systemic racism in North Dakota that you don't see unless you're Native. I go back and tell this story. I did a project when I was the Attorney General. We were looking at juvenile justice reform, and we did a big, you know, kind of a town hall, but we brought in children from all over, usually junior high and high school kids, to talk about their experience and their lives and what we could do to make it easier and curb this increase in juvenile crime. And a young girl from Turtle Mountain stood up. Turtle Mountain is the Ojibwe band that is just right on the border between us and Canada in kind of as central North Dakota. And she stood up and she said, "We stopped to buy soda at the convenience store before we came here. And we all got off the bus." And she said, "Every one of us got followed around in that convenience store." And she said, "You know what it made me want to do?" And I thought, well, this is interesting. She said, "It made me want to steal something."
Mm.
And I think that you don't realize that how you make people feel is so significant, you know. And it's the old adage that people won't remember what you said, but they will remember how you made them feel. And we need to be more aware of those behaviors. And that certainly is true in states like North Dakota and in Montana and in South Dakota. And you know, one thing I will say, I applaud our governor. Our governor, I think, has been the first governor in a number of years that has done meaningful outreach and culturally significant outreach to the tribes. And I think that's critical as we look at the government-to-government relationships and how important it is for us to have a federal tribal state kind of collaboration to address some of these issues. But at the end of the day, we need to demand that the federal government live up to its obligations.
As you know, Senator Heitkamp, this program is called Talking Beats, and I always ask people about their favorite music, what they really love to listen to, no matter if they're musician or non-musician. So what do you like to listen to? How does music play a role in your life?
You know, I am so stuck in the late 60s and early 70s, you know, and I try. I really do try. But you know, I put together a playlist because I'm now with COVID, I'm trying to figure out some way to stay sane, and so I've started dusted off my old Trek bike, which is 30 years old, and I've been biking. We're so blessed here in our community to have great bike paths, and I'm pulling out music, and I realize, man, you are stuck. You know, Bob Seger can't be just the end all and be all of what you listen to. I listen to a lot of women artists and a lot of kind of crossover folk, you know, Joni Mitchell, Joan Baez. You know, I love the Dixie Chicks. That's maybe the most current now called the Chicks. God bless them for that change. And I think you look at people like Amy Winehouse, who came kind of after that, you know, troubled souls, but yet incredibly talented people. Adele's incredibly talented. And we're seeing now Billie Eilish, you know, so we're seeing this new generation of women performers that are being Lizzo, being so creative. And I think that speaks to kind of this new generation of women. And I will use the word feminists, because I believe that that's not a pejorative. That is, in fact, exercising their power as human beings and not fitting in the typical stereotypes. And that certainly is true today for kind of these new artists that are emerging. But I have to tell you, if you said you could take Adele, who I love, and you could go biking with her, it wouldn't be her. It would be Bob Seger and Amy Winehouse and some of my other favorites. You know, my all-time favorite, have to confess, Janis Joplin. You know, if I could have seen her in concert, I think I would never have gone to another concert. She was a unique talent. When you read her history, you know, from growing up in really what was very lower middle class kind of white Texas, and going to the blues clubs and watching and listening and you know, picking that kind of music, you know, she could have done anything, but yet she brought such a unique style to her music, and just, I think, such a joy. And what's really obviously sad to see an artist like that. I forget what anniversary of Jimi Hendrix's birthday is today or yesterday. You know, 27 years old, but yet look at the impact he had. Look at the impact Janis Joplin had. And you know, I just have to say that people always say, well, what did your husband get you for your birthday? And I'm like, we don't give gifts. But one year for my birthday, my husband, he was giddy. He couldn't wait. So he gave it to me early. And he had been searching for literally a wood saw, right? You know, because table saw, because he's a woodworker. And came across this thing called Wood Nymph and thought, oh, that's interesting, when he was searching on eBay. And this is a number of years ago. And what it was a pastel painting that Grace Slick did of Janis Joplin that the owner was selling because they wanted to buy a house. And my husband splurged at the time, and I now have that painting. And every time I see it, it reminds me of these women who came before, you know, the Lizzos, who really broke a barrier, I think, especially in rock and roll, especially in blues, that paved the way. And we all stand on someone's shoulders. You know, you think about Heidi Heitkamp, you know, well, yeah, I was the first of a lot of things, but yet I stand on the shoulders of people like Barbara Mikulski and Nancy Kassebaum and Margaret Chase Smith. And so you think about all the women who came before you, and now at the 100th anniversary of the women's right to vote, and we're learning more about the history of those great patriots who fought for that kind of equality. It's humbling to think about what they sacrificed so that we could attempt to have a political voice in America is really humbling.
Just to clarify for everybody, September 18th, 1970, Jimi Hendrix died 50 years ago. It's September 18th right now when we're talking. So that is quite extraordinary. Talk about outsized influence and dying at a young age. Just to think about Mozart, 34, age 34, yeah. He died. Schubert was 31. These people who helped shape music, helped shape culture for the rest of history. And they're drawn to it. They can't not do it. It's their calling. And they used every second they had.
You know, the old song, only the good die young. Well, I don't know that that's true. Hope it's not true. But certainly no one has forgotten Jimi Hendrix. No one has forgotten Janis Joplin. No one has forgotten Mozart or Schubert. I mean, and so the one thing that for, especially for young people who listen to your middle of the pack millennial, you can have incredible impact. And you don't have to wait. You don't have to say, oh, that's for when I'm older. You know, if you pursue your passion, you can change outcomes and have incredible impact, I think.
Heidi Heitkamp, I know we're a little short on time, but you're so fun to talk music with. That I could do that forever, but just take us to this fall, if you could give a bit of a preview, because it's wonderful to talk about music. There's nothing more fun, but a little bit of politics, if you could. I wonder what you're seeing as we're coming into fall 2020. You're heavily involved in organization you founded with the former senator from Indiana, Joe Donnelly, One Country Project, which aims to connect rural America back to what I guess you see as sort of original democratic roots in rural America. Tell us a little about this, what you're doing with that, how it plays into the election right now.
Well, I've been discouraged in part because I think that it leads to an ungovernable country in these kind of regional and demographic kind of pigeonholing that we do in politics. Oh, those are African Americans, they're going to vote Republican. Or those are, you know, suburban women, and that's our target audience. And, you know, so we have kind of wiped off the mat individualism in some ways in America. And as a result of that, I think you're seeing more polarization regionally, politically. And, you know, we used to elect Byron Dorgan and Ken Conrad, both very prominent, very successful Democratic senators from North Dakota, Tom Daschle and Tim Johnson from South Dakota, Bob Kerry, who's gotten to be a great friend of mine and a remarkable human being from Nebraska. He and Ben Nelson and you know, Lloyd Benson from Texas. And so why aren't we doing that anymore? And it's kind of like hurt feelings because, you know, the New Deal, when you ask my grandmother why she was a member of the Democratic NPL party in North Dakota, she would say, because FDR put food on my table. And when nobody else would help us, the Democratic Party was there. And I think that's still true of the Democratic Party. But yet we have lost the ability to communicate in rural America. And so we're trying to figure out, number one, how we can better explain policies, but how we also can better explain rural America to urban America, to those Congress people from Manhattan and San Francisco and LA, so that they can understand that these are not folks that are, the stereotypical people, but they are good people who care about the same thing you care about: educating our kids, building this country, protecting their families, you know, putting a roof over their head and food on the table, and making sure that when you get sick, you don't go broke. And, you know, I just don't understand why in America we're so divided when what we want fundamentally as human beings is the same thing. And so what we're really focused on is building back the rural economy, but also, you know, kind of working to make sure that Democrats represent rural America too, and that we're going to see more electoral success. One thing that we've seen, and a lot of people from bigger places resent North Dakota or New Hampshire's, you know, electoral votes, given the number of people that we have. But that's the system that we have. And if you want to be successful in the Senate, if you want to be in securing leadership of the Senate or in the presidency, you're going to have to learn how to talk to rural voters. And that's been our pitch. And I'm really proud, I think, for the first time in a long time, there is a heavy focus on rural voters in the Democratic Party. And I think we've driven a lot of that discussion.
Bernie Sanders said recently that Joe Biden should be reaching more out to the progressive wing, and then there are other people who say the exact opposite. What do you hope to see in terms of reaching out one way or another? Or is that just too simplistic of a way of questioning that issue?
I think, again, it's parsing those. I think what Joe Biden should do is think about what the American public needs right now and how we're going to deliver that, and not worry about whether the progressive wing or the conservative wing, because if he leads with good ideas that improve the quality of middle class life, he's going to be successful and we're all going to be just thrilled. By improving middle class life is taking care of what's happening with income disparity in this country, which is tearing us apart and could lead to very dire outcomes. The disparity in healthcare that we see now with COVID, vulnerable populations, people in poverty, much more susceptible to early death as a result of this disease. Minority businesses closing at record numbers compared to other businesses. People having on the lower income ladder having a difficult time finding work again because they typically worked in service industry, whether it was in spas or retail or restaurants, and those are having a harder time coming back. And we see the vulnerabilities, which is exacerbated and magnified by this pandemic. And those are the things that he needs to focus on. What are his ideas to change those outcomes and to create a more equal and just America? And when we focus on those and not checking the box on a progressive wing or on a conservative wing, that's when we're doing the work of America. And I think that's exactly what Joe Biden's doing in it. It makes me proud to be a supporter of his.
Leave us with a little optimism. What are you optimistic about? What do you just smile to yourself about as you go on that bike ride on the old Trek or Schwinn?
It's a Trek.
A Trek.
Not that I'm dissing the Schwinn, but you know, and I've gotten really partial to my old 30-year-old bike. Let me tell you.
Exactly. The old 30-year-old bike you get on, you put on music, you're smiling. What gives you hope and optimism?
I get optimistic about the next generation because I think they're less selfish than the baby boomers. I think that they're more realistic than the baby boomers. I think that they have better life-work balances than baby boomers. And so I'm really optimistic because of young people. I'd love to tell you I'm optimistic because I think that my generation, aka the baby boomers, have left this government in such great shape. It's absolutely not true. I had a line that I used. I said, we will be the first generation, maybe baby boomers, that borrowed from our children and inherited from our parents. We inherited a free world from the greatest generation. We inherited, you know, really low debt and deficit. We inherited great infrastructure. And we selfishly have been unwilling to continue to fight for those things. When I see, number one, polling numbers from millennials and people younger, I see in there reflected the goodness. And maybe we baby boomers can take credit because we raised millennials. And maybe those are the values we raise them with. But I think the next generation of Americans are going to be much more driven by their values and much less driven by their pay.
Senator Heidi Heitkamp, North Dakota, I think a lot of people hope to see you back in that position or something similar. Amplify your voice as much as possible. It's needed, a voice of civility and compassion. And I thank you.
Daniel, you are so remarkable, and I look forward to seeing you perform in Minnesota.
You've been listening to Talking Beats with Daniel Lalchuk. I hope you'll subscribe and leave a review on Apple, Spotify, or anywhere you get your podcasts. The original theme music for this program is by Ronald Markham. The content coordinator is Nathaniel Mosse. Doug Christian is the executive producer. I'm Daniel Lalchuk. See you next time.